Thank you for watching Urban TV. I'm Jackie Achan. Now, recently, the New Vision carried a story in which it indicated that the Ministry of Internal Affairs had raised concern that most of the young women and girls leaving the country are doing so to go and work in Saudi Arabia because many are victims of domestic violence. They have to leave their abusive relationships, go to Saudi Arabia or the Middle East and try to fend a living for themselves and the children perhaps they have in these relationships and their families. So today we speak to Sheila Harriet Nankunda, who shares her personal story with us. Please introduce yourself.
Hello everyone, I'm called Nankunda Harriet Sheila. I come from Kanung district, but I was born and raised here in Kampala. I'm the first born out of the five kids for my mother, and I'm the fourth born on my father's side. So I went to St. Peter's Primary School. I went to Sambia Girls, St. Joseph's, and then Progressive, Boyogere. Yeah, that's where I completed my HSC from. From there, I didn't proceed to the university. I just had to do some work. Yeah. So when I was growing up, I grew up with actually most of the times my mom, because my dad was an army man. He used to move up and down. He was rarely at home, visit once in a while. So everything was basically on our mom, but she tried her best. And we grew up in the best way. Yeah, I never knew how to board a taxi. I never knew how to go to the market. I never knew even how to go to Owino to buy anything. Everything used to find us at home. Because she was a business lady. She was dealing in spare parts. So she was most of the times going abroad and then coming back for her business. So she was doing business on Cooper Complex. Before it was, I think, Cooper Motors. Yeah, right now Cooper Complex. So that was like our street. Every time from school, everyone knows you, uncle, auntie, ice cream, chocolate, like that, yeah. So we grew up in such an environment where you know there is a car at home, everywhere you're going, they have to drive you, they have to pick you up, you know. Yeah, we never missed bread. Everything was okay, actually. I liked the childhood. And especially when you used to visit the village, like festive seasons, and everyone is like, wow, they come from Kampala, you know. You are the same because you come from that village. But they see you like you're different. So there was no difference, only that they see you are from town. So every Christmas would feel like we're waiting for that day to go to the village. You see, giving other kids bread, soda, eating rice, you know. So it used to be like fun, having fun every time. I liked it. I enjoyed it. During my senior four, my mom passed on. Yeah. So that was a big challenging step in my life. Now everything had to change. I had to cope up, like you have to stay with an auntie. You have to like adjust, everything has to change. That life, yeah, we used to, sometimes the eating, the dressing, yeah, things had to change, but I used to comfort my young ones. I tell them, no, things will be okay. We just have to grow up and you have to do everything our mom wanted us to do, at least to keep her happy wherever she is. You see, not see her like she's sad or what, you know, because I know that dead are not dead. Yeah, so the moment you're like sad every time you're mourning, she also not be resting. So we have to be happy to leave her rest in peace. Yeah.
What was that thing inside you that forced you to get a boyfriend?
And now, you know, like every time maybe I would leave work, I'm going back home. So sometimes I would play, like we had some colleagues, okay, almost the same age, though they didn't go to school, some boys, I would tell them, come and escort me to the taxi park. Come and help me cross the road. Sometimes they tell you, go and buy bread shop, right? Buy sugar, buy milk. So I'm scared to go there alone. I wasn't used. So I have to get somebody to give me company. That's what I was like. Now, when this friend of mine came into my life, I was like, now I need a company. I need somebody to be like helping me here and there. Yeah, maybe like when I'm going to visit my young ones at school, I need somebody to go with. Yeah.
So how did it end with this?
And actually with him, it didn't go far. Mm. Mm. It didn't go far. Mm. We got some misunderstandings because every time, okay, he wanted us to move in together, but it was like, I told him, if you are to move in together, I want to stay with my siblings, at least the last one. I want to be with her. And she's like, no, I cannot, we cannot build your family here now, right now. I'm not yet set. You know, I told him, no, whatever it is, whether we are eating or not, I want to be with her. So I had to give him that condition. And for him, he was feeling like it's not, he's not comfortable with it. And I told him, then it's okay. We quit. Mm. My dream marriage was like any other girl. I want to finish up my programs. I want to do the introduction. I want to do the wedding and then move in with my husband. We start life together. Like we are all starting that marriage and have to learn things together. But here I got into a marriage where somebody was older than me. He already has kids and they're like more experienced than me. And so I thought I would learn from him, but instead it was the other side. I had to work on orders. You have to work on like being directed. Don't do this, don't go here, don't do that. You know, I'm older than you, I know a lot. Don't talk to her and so, you know. So now it's like, again, I was back to being controlled the way I was controlled at home. I didn't have any freedom. So for me, I wanted somebody like my age mate, where we can fight, we can have those like, you know, funny moments. But here, now I'm here, you have to respect somebody, you know. When I tell you, when we're in Botswana, actually, you know, now you know people know somebody's abroad, he's earning a lot, I don't know. But he had some other two kids, he didn't tell me, outside the other three. So it happened one evening, he was on a call, talking to somebody. So after that call, it was a long call and like some arguments, I was like, why? He's not talking to me, like telling me anything about this call. I gave it call, I just took it call. Later when he slept off, I had got that habit, you know, God should forgive me. I got the phone and checked the number. So I got the number, it was a Ugandan number. I had to call it again. And I didn't say anything. So here the lady calling, which, you know, making that noise about the kid. I was like, ah, which kid is this? I first ignored, but after some few days, I have to confront him and ask him, who is the owner of this number and whose kid is this and this and that? So he was like, started gambling, you know, this, that. Told him, why didn't you tell me before? If I accepted you, there are three kids, so why didn't you tell me even there's a fourth one? Why do you have to lie to me, you know? So I started getting broken-hearted again. And I remember one time I asked him for money for my daughter back home. He told me I don't have money, so I made noise. I told him, you know what? You give money to your old year wives who are there taking care of other kids, but my baby's not getting even care back home. I sacrificed to come here. I left my job. I left everything I was doing. I would be even very far. But now I'm just here like a housewife. I'm not doing anything for myself, wasting my life on somebody who is already having a queue of kids and wives, you know. So we had the noise that night, and even he ended up beating me up. So when he beat me up, I told him, okay, it's not the end of the day. Don't worry. I kept quiet. So my baby was around 8 months old. I told him I want to go back home. He was like, when I get money. So I kept on insisting I want to go back home. And he refused. So when my baby girl, she wasn't taking anything. She just wanted breastfeeding. And I felt like I'm fed up. You have to stop breastfeeding. I have to look for a job. I have to do something myself. I can't stay in the house like this. After knowing there is... So there's no development. Because I wasn't seeing any development at all. The way he gets the salary list, the way it's dispatched, and I even don't know where the money goes. And you end up at the end of the month, even nothing in the house, you know. I'm wondering, how am I going to continue with such a life? So when that girl made 1 year, I had to stop breastfeeding her. And actually, I didn't tell him. So he went to work early in the morning, and I woke up and I'm like, no, I have to get a plan. So I told her this, you know what, you have to stop breastfeeding. Take milk, take porridge, you eat food. Now at least you're a grown-up girl. So I had to just use Colgate. I smeared it on my breast. And whenever she see that, the white, whatever, that thing, she would get away scared. She would cry. So even when he came back, he found her making noise, crying. Why did you stop breeding the baby? What I told him, no, I have to look for something to do. At least 1 year is enough for her. She thought everything is okay. He was like, no, you can't do that. Maybe you are getting other relationships here. Now you don't want to breastfeed the baby because you know it will affect the baby. I told him, no, I can't do that. If I'm done with you, I'll quit and get another person, but I can't handle two relationships at a time. She was like, I don't understand you. Why did you do that without my permission? I told him, not everything, you have to get your permission. Actually, that thing, it went too far. I thought it was just a joke. I told him, you know, out of joking, I was like, if she doesn't want to eat, let her die. It's okay. But she has to eat. For me, I just put my baby in the back. I went in the kitchen. I was doing some cooking. The next thing I heard was like a doorbell ringing at the gate. And I'm like, I wasn't expecting anyone to be coming here, any visitor or what, because it was a working day. So I had the car enter in to check in the window. I'm seeing a police car. I'm wondering. So they came in and they talked to him. He was seated outside in the compound. They talked to him and then they called me, came and called me, say, madam, we want to talk to you. We need a statement, blah, blah. A statement about what? You know you threatened to kill this baby. We've got the information. You've been called by your husband. I'm like, whoa. And she was even at the back sleeping. So they told me you have to go to the station and you make a statement. You know, for them, they are very, very sensitive. The moment, even like most about the kids are for the nation, it's not your kid. Make a small beating, the neighbor will make a call and they'll come for you. So that one had committed a crime to say that I had threatened to kill the baby, I don't know what, you know. Said, okay, no problem. Good enough, I had my cousin's sister, the husband was working with Stanbic Bank and they were also there. So I called them, I told them what had happened. And they said, okay, you go and see what will happen next. We are waiting. Went to the station, they made a statement. There were whatever I said. Then they got me, they told me, give us the baby. They handed over the baby to him and they put me inside, in the cell. So he takes the baby to my cousin. So my sister said, no, you did it yourself, so handle your baby. Actually, so many people were attached. You know? The Ugandan community there, they were like, how can you do this to your wife? How? So I was like, oh. I spent a night there. So my sister did her best with her husband. They got a lawyer. They went and talked to them. In the evening, they released me. So when I came back home, my sister told me, you know what, Sheila, you cannot manage. You cannot move on like this. You need a life. I didn't expect something small to leave you, make you like sleep in a cell. I wasn't myself, you know. Now my heart has started changing. I'm like, I'm not living with a person. I'm not living with a human being, you know. Because I've not done anything, I'm struggling with this baby. I wanted her the best for her, you know. So I end up like, I never expected I can sleep in jail. I was like, shh. Then my sister told me, you know what, we can even buy you a ticket. You go back home. I told them, let him do it. I kept quiet. I even had talked to the family here. I told them, if you don't talk to your brother to control himself, this is not a life. This is not how they handle people. This is not how they handle issues. But life moves on. We'll see what will happen next. So that's how things are still happening in the house. No, you no longer trust me. I no longer trust you. I'm also feeling that bad heart like in me. Why are you torturing me like this, you know? So good enough, we completed the contract and we had to come back here. So coming back here, things will not work on. When you smile with a friend, when you go back home, that's a beating. When you have a phone call, he doesn't know, the next thing, it's a beating, you know. So later on, I found there's another kid, those are 5 now, you know. But for me now, I said no. You know this queue, now let me stay with 2. I cannot move on, I cannot add on. I rather stay with the 2 I'll manage, take care of. Because by the end of that day, you find they are 30 and they are not going to survive because there is no money. The job contract had entered, we had come back, now had to start a new life looking for jobs here and there. I told him I want to go back to work. He told me if you want to go back to work, I have to look for money, you do this and this, you try for business. I told him, no, the business I know best is spare parts, so I can go back to the street. On that line, I have so many friends, like my aunties, my uncles. I can coop up with spares. And he's like, no, you cannot go back there. You want to go back to your ex-boyfriends there. You know. So everything was always like, you have to go under orders. I'm like, okay, as you wish. We are renting. I have to pay fees for the kids. They have to eat. They have to do everything. But there is no job, no salary, no savings at all. So now I'm like, where are we going to? Where are we heading to? We used to go for prayers in Mukarango with my kids. We sleep there overnight, at least for him to get a job. Thank God he got some jobs. He used to get jobs, contracts here and there because he was a senior journalist. But at the end of the day, the way he makes the money, you don't know. Because by the time he comes back from somewhere, maybe he'd been staying there for 3 months, so his first stop will be in the bar with a friend. Maybe he can spend there like $200, the least. comes back home, you don't have to control me, it's my money. Okay. We have to do this, we have to do that, don't give me orders, I know what I'm doing, I'm an adult. And the bad thing, the family thinks it's you who is like consuming the money, having the good life. Because for me, I would not lack anything. Anytime like I'm missing anything, I would call my brother, call my auntie. At least I would nag them. And for them, they would just know the moment Sheila calls, maybe she wants to buy a new watch, maybe she wants to buy a necklace, maybe she wants to buy this. So I would make sure I move on with my life comfortably. And for him, he would think he's having men who are doing that for her, you know. Because sometimes, like my sisters, the young ones, they would find, because my young sister was working at Coca-Cola, and she would like get her sorely and say, I bought for you this, we are there the weekend, she comes, visit you, do this, do that. She, you know, she does, she tells me, sister, I don't want you to see, I don't want you to see you sad, because you've gone through a lot, and you've sacrificed a lot for us. I feel bad when they are treating you like this, but this is not the life you're supposed to live. So, after some time, we agreed, I told him I want to go back study. So during my boredom in Botswana, I tried my level best. I did a diploma course when I was pregnant, not to be in the house so much. At least I did a diploma course in human resource management, and I came back with a diploma. That was my achievement and my baby. Tried to look for jobs here, nothing. So I told him I want to go back for a degree course, to enroll at least for another course. Said we'll try, at least I can contribute, my family can contribute for me, and you also contribute for me, and we'll see how I can go on with the course. And he told me, yeah, I'll see, I'll organize, I'll talk to my friends. Said, fine. But of course, actually for me, I wanted so much to do psychology. That was my main interest. And for him, he was like, no, you have to go for journalism. Because that was his side, that was his side of career. I told him, but I don't see anything I'm going to do in journalism because I'm not interested. I'm not so much good in talking. I won't be going on TV, make noise, radio, make noise. Because for me, I thought that's all about journalism. So what I did, I said, okay, because whatever he says, that's what you're supposed to do, you know. So I said, okay. He got the forms, I filled them, I applied. Thank God, I was given the course at Makerere University. So when I was given that course, good enough, he got some money. He told me, you can do business, you can work, and then you go to study in the evening, because I applied for the evening classes. So when he got that money to go and work, I told him I want to go and trade into spares. He was like, no. Because now what am I going to do? Retail shop, go and trade in clothes, I don't know, but at least here, I have guidance, and I know at least I have that experience. He was like, no. So what for him, he decided we have to make a restaurant. We opened up a restaurant in Namugongo. But we are staying on Entebbe Road. We are opening up a restaurant in Namugongo. You know? So for me, I just saw him and I was like, are you sitting down? Listen to yourself. Just make that accountability. I transport from here to Namugongo every day and coming back. And I have to be committing to campus. You have to put in workers, the rent, the other bills. How much are you going to spend per month? He's like, it's not your business, it's not your money, it's not. So I'm like, okay, no problem. We opened up that restaurant. Opening up a restaurant, it was next to the shrine, but that place is more of a residential. So there are not many people there during working days, maybe if there's any occasion at the church. That's when you would get a few customers. But these other days, you would see the whole day, there's nothing. But we are paying 650 for rent every month. We had two waitresses. I had the chef, because yes, I know how to cook, but I'm not like advanced in cooking for restaurant. Like these snacks, what? So we had to hire a chef. Those maids, the waitresses, they have to get 300 per month. They have to get transport. The chef gets 500. So add on the rent and then the bills, plus my transport. So at the end of the day, what are we doing? Just wasting. I tried to talk to the sister, but they were like, well, the good thing, you don't want to listen to him. You never know, things will work out. I told him, it's okay. I'll wake up every morning, go sit there. In the evening, I go to class. I leave the workers there. So the moment you leave them there, even if they have made 10,000, you will not see it. They tell you we didn't do anything, you know. So it was just like a wastage. And everything, the blame is on me. So the good thing, my girls used to be in boarding school. We started having those wrangles. Sometimes I come back home late. from campus, you have to commit to the taxi park, coming back, you come back late, you've been somewhere, you didn't go to school, I know, I talked to your friends, you are not there. I'm like, so the fights were so more often. Good enough, my girls were in boarding school. I didn't want them to experience that. But sometimes it would even happen when they're at home, and I would feel bad. You see the baby comforting me in the morning, mommy, sorry, but daddy beat you, why is daddy like this, why is daddy behaving like this, you know? I always feel bad to see my girls like crying every time like that. I'll tell them, no, it's okay, it will be okay. Yeah, yesterday I was reading that story for Wizzo's wife and I felt so bad. One time I was beaten, it was a Friday night and there was a wedding the next day for the sister and you have to go. So you have to go with your face is when or what you have to go and everyone is looking at you, you are the topic of the wedding. Because everyone knows the beating that happens there every day. I try to tell him, please, if you see uncomfortable with us, just leave me with my kids. Good enough, we are renting. I'll take care of myself and the kids. Get another wife and leave us. Give me peace. Because the moment you push me more, you don't know what will happen next. When the time I feel like I've hated myself more, you don't know what will happen next. I don't want anything to happen to you, or lose my kids, or lose myself. But he was like, you didn't marry me, I married you. So you have to bear everything that happens. But things came to the worst and I could not stand the situation anymore. Because I told him, if you're a genuine person, you love your family, get your kids, all the kids you know you have, put them here, I'll take care of them. Let me sit home and babysit the kids. Then we know the closed chapter for your wives and the spending is done, so that we can develop, do something good. And he's like, take care of your kids, you have your own, leave the others the way they are. So myself, I'm like, maybe he's still meeting these ladies. He's still going there because you have to go and give support. You have to go and see the kid, you know. So I lost that trust completely. I didn't have love in my heart anymore. I just look at him like the father of my kids. Sometimes I will sleep with my kids in their bedroom when they are around. When they are not around, it's my room. That was also another trouble. You're a married woman. You are supposed to. I'm no longer comfortable there. I was even scared for my life. Because you're moving here and there, I don't know. You know, I was scared for my life so much. And I was like, I have to get out of this. It's enough. I tried to talk, now I became the bad person. Everyone is like, no, she's the bad person. She doesn't want to work. Maybe she has gone back to campus. She's having boyfriends, what that. But I had just to look on. But it was too much for me. So I say I have put everything to an end. My kids were young. I didn't have a job. That restaurant wasn't bringing in much. I said no. You know, there's a time I hated myself and even my family was like, Shina, are you the one? You know, I wanted to be like every 24/7 I'm drunk because I hated everything about myself. I hated my life. I hated the life I was living. So when I don't have money for a beer, maybe I'll look for money for just a small drink. Maybe I sleep. I don't want to think about anything like I didn't care about these other relationships or what, lying to me, that mistrust. When beating me in front of my kids, it was too much. Yeah. Because I think that's something they can never forget. Even up to now, they've grown up, but still they are like, mommy, we don't have much, but at least we are happy. Because you are okay. We are no longer like worried about you. Yeah, but before they would be at school, but they are not even studying well because they're always worried, thinking, if mommy is okay.
When was the first time they beat you in front of the kids?
That was, we had come back here actually, because now they were a little bit, I think one was around 6 years and one was around 4 years. That was around 2009. And you know, the ones coming to see, mommy, come, no, don't sleep there, don't go to the bedroom. Because I felt, there's one time I felt like I wanted to hurt him more, but actually, when I saw my daughter crying, I said, no, I don't want to make this because I might end up killing their dad and they will never forgive me. Yeah, just say, let me take control of myself. Because I just got a bottle, I just felt like I want to throw that bottle at him. Maybe he loses the eye. That's when you know that beating somebody to get like souls, it's not good. You also get hurt. But I just said, let me control myself. Because at the time he slapped me and I was my cousin's sister at home who were taking tea, I had to splash that tea on him. So if it was hot, maybe I would be in jail, you know. So sometimes I would get hot up and I'm like, why is it like every day it has to happen, even when there's a visitor? And out of nowhere. So I would like to avoid all this. I'd rather stay a single life. A phone call can make you be beaten. The moment he comes back home before you, you have to be beaten, you know. The moment you say, maybe I'm going to visit my friend, or somebody comes to visit you, he will just watch over, sit down, then wait for the visitor to go. He didn't want visitors. He had to choose for you the friends. Sometimes he even used to call my friends, even some very, very close relatives. So you are her, like mediator. You are the go-between between her and her friends. So you are the one like calling her for parties so that she can meet other people there, you know, confronting other people every day, abusing them out of nowhere. So you find somebody is no longer talking to you, and what happened? I'm tired of your husband abusing me. I've got enough calls, I've got enough insults, you know. If he can slap you in a taxi.
Tell me, what happened in a taxi?
If somebody can slap you in a taxi in public.
What is the story?
So, you know, some things are very, very funny. One time we were coming back from Zambia, from his cousin's place. And we were all taking drinks. So he gives the conductor money, and this guy says, Mzee, sente zivurako yongerako, you know? He said, how much do you want from Zambia to town? The man says, I think he wanted 700, and he was giving like 500 for it. He was like, no, tamanyira sora zikuwa, muliba siru, which is, I told him, because of me, 200. Stop making noise, you are an adult. So even before, like, just answering you anything, he just gave me a slap. He told me, don't answer when I'm talking to people, you're stupid. Oya gara genda kwa se, tomanyira, you know. I felt so small. I felt so ashamed. I even felt like I wish I can pass through this window of the taxi and get out of the car. But I just had to play it cool and keep quiet. I didn't say anything. They made their noise. Till when we reached town, for me, I just got out of the taxi and moved. I didn't say anything because I was so much embarrassed in front of people who were there in the taxi. And everyone was like, ah, I know Musaji Yakulira. Musaji Wonyoma and Gogunyera, you know? Such things. And wondering, you are somebody who goes in front of a class, you are lecturing students, you are doing this, you're a public figure. I'm like, oh.
And
so that was like, everyone was like, enough is enough. No one wanted to listen to me anymore. No one wanted like to hear any of my stories anymore. They're like, enough is enough. We are done. We are just tired with you people. We are tired with you, you know? So I'm like, now what happens next? If I lose my life, why am I forcing this life? You know, the marriage was only for 13 years, but it was hell. You know somebody, you get a car at home, you've struggled, you pray, God, I pray, we build the house, we get a car, we get this. Somehow God will answer a little bit. You get a car, at least you can start living that simple life. You are not supposed to touch that car. You are not supposed to drive that car. You have to hire a driver to drive you where you are going. Your family is none of his business. His car is for his family, and maybe if you are going somewhere, the driver will take you and drop you. At least he will pay that salary for the driver. But you are not supposed to handle that key, drive that car. And you are the wife at home. So how can you stay in such, really? I try to, like, maybe God should help me and make a way. I try to pray. I'm a Catholic. I used to go to Bukarango, pray overnight, do the fasting. Please change for me something. But, and I'm like, if I continue forcing life, the worst will happen. So, when I quit, the earlier, the better. Move on, do something else. Yeah, we had a fight that day, we separated. He moved out after beating me badly. My kids were not at home, they were at school. I stayed in the house. He went to the sister's place. He stayed there, I think, for 2 days. So when I was talking to my family, my uncles, they were like, whatever something happens, if they come and kill you in the house, if someone comes and something for you in the house, the best thing for you to do is leave that house. So I had to pack out of that house. I left the house. I left some things of his. I got mine. So he also had to come and get his things and find where to stay. When the kids got holidays, at first I left the kids to go to him. They went to the sister's place. The next time it was, well, I think it was, I don't know what happened. He didn't want to even send the kids to school. I just had to ignore. Because for me, the moment I left, I had to stay a little while with my auntie. Then I went to work with my dad in Karamoja, my uncle, brother, my late dad. He's also an army man. He was working in Karamoja by then, in Akapiripirit. So I went there, I told him. Actually, he even didn't expect me. I just talked to my cousin. He told me, no, I'll give you directions. I boarded from Kampala up to Akapiripirit. I just called my dad when I was just nearby. I told him, just direct me where you stay. So good enough, he was staying in a barracks. I went to the barracks, I stayed with him. For every time, almost was coming to a year. Started getting some small jobs with small NGOs there, working here and there, you know. Sometimes I'll just come to Kampala over a weekend, check on my kids, and I go back. Just check on them at school, and I go back. Because I didn't want to meet like anybody was that was close to us. I didn't want to meet those friends, the family members. I just wanted to live my simple life alone. I just wanted to have that privacy, start afresh, you know. So time happened when my uncle was going to Somalia. Their unit was going to Somalia, and he had to go. Because he was the head, so I had nothing to do. He told me, you're not safe here alone. You have to come back to Kampala. I can't leave you here. You have to come back to Kampala, and then we'll see what to do. But you'll get something to do. Because remember, I had cancelled my studies. The restaurant was already, but you cannot do anything. That was his business. I left it for him and his family. I don't know what happened next, because I didn't even go back there. You know, the moment for me, I say it's done, it's done. I even want to meet you. By the way, you hear people that negative side, the way they look at the things. For them, they think a good life for the kid. Wake up every morning, put the kid on the bus or pick her, drop her. That's the good life they want. My mom had a car, she had everything, but she never picked any kid from school. Maybe when you get holidays, that's all. Or you're going back to school, she'll drop you. That's all. But she'll never like morning, evening, pick you. No way. That didn't happen. So I learned that myself, and it worked for us. When she was gone, we managed to move on because we were in boarding schools, even my young siblings, because they were used to that life. The little time they would come back home, of course, they would miss her, but most of the times they were in school, you know. The time for holidays is a little bit short. So for me, I used to make sure, like, avoiding that closeness at home with him. Because even for them, most of the times they are scared. Every time he comes back, they are like, Daddy, they would even abandon the TV, go to their bedroom, keep quiet, because they are scared. You know, a simple thing, even a kid is doing something, you know, so the kid gets like that fear in her. Every time you come back home, there's no love, there's no peace, they're scared. They were still growing up. Because by the time we were separated, my firstborn was in primary 6 and then was in primary 4. Yeah. Yeah, of course, they were understanding. Even though we still have those memories.
Well, tell me any story that happened where. Maybe the one you remember
most, where he actually assaulted you and those kids were there, and perhaps it had that impact on all of you. So that there's a time they were going back to school. You know, every time they would be going back to school the last weekend, we used to take them out. So that time he gave me money for shopping, for their shopping, and it was actually a Friday. So he said, no, we'll do it tomorrow. And that the next day on Saturday, he said, no, let's take the kids out. Then we can do the shopping tomorrow as we go back to school. Because they used to not take a lot of things. They were not taking like eats or what, just essential things. Because they were in St. Agnes in Agarama. No eats, no pocket money, nothing. So we went out with the kids. When we were going out, I told my firstborn, Lynn, take this money, keep it in your room. I don't want that money to stay in my room because we might misuse it and it will cause me problems. So I gave her the money to keep it. For him, he thought I had moved with the money in the pocket. So we went. Actually, we were on Sarama Road. There was some joint on Sarama Road. So later he told me, you know, he was drinking, he bought it and he called some friend. He told me, first give me some little money, I'll give it to you back tomorrow. Then I told him which money. So I gave you money at home. Where did you put the money? I told her, oh, I gave the money to the owners. It wasn't mine. Ask her, she's the one with the money. So when he asked the girl, he said, ah, Daddy, the sentence say you work. Mommy hasn't paid any zitereka. I left the money at home. He got furious. You are stupid. Why can't you give money? You give the money to the kids. What I told him, these kids understand. Because it's their money for shopping. It wasn't my money. Why do you expect him to move with money for the kids for shopping in a bar or in a restaurant, in an open place like that? So when I said like that, I told him, you want to impress everyone. So you take your debts, you clear them. It's up to you, you know better. So he felt embarrassed in front of his friends, and he was having a glass of beer. He just poured the beer at me. So when I stood up to move out, he just pulled my hair back. Sit down. You're not supposed to move out. Walk on me. Sit down. What I told him, I'm not your kid. Leave me alone. Then he slapped me and pushed me on the next table. So the girls, they were eating, but they started crying. And they were scared to move out of where they were, you know. So when I fell down, everyone was looking at me. I just got up, I moved out, I went in there. And they also stopped eating, they started crying. So everyone was like, what's this?